name is Eddie J. Kim from the law firm of Lynch Carpenter, and I represent this. Let me just say at the outset, this is a little bit confusing, but this case originated as Schertzer versus the Bank of America. There were multiple plaintiffs, there were multiple defendants. We're here to represent the only plaintiff, Brittany Covell, regarding her claims only against Bank of America and not the other ATM defendants that were once a part of this case.
Counsel, are you going to reserve any of your time?
If I may, I'd like to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal.
Very well. Keep track of that time for you.
This consumer class action seeks to stop one of the most abusive systematic practices relating to excessive fees being assessed for use of out-of-network ATM machines. And what happened to Plaintiff Covell is an example that's both typical and shocking. Ms. Covell was a Bank of America customer at the time when she walked into a 7-Eleven, went to an ATM machine to withdraw $20. Those ATM machines are all operated by an independent ATM operator called SCTI, Inc., which was once a defendant in this case. When you insert your card, your debit card, into the machine, and then you enter your PIN, it asks what language that you'd like to proceed. And after all of that, the first thing that it prompts you is, would you like to view your account balance? As many other ATM machines that people have seen, usually you start with a main menu and you get to choose what you want to do. In this ATM interface, which is uniform for all of the SCTI machines at 7-Eleven, the first prompt is, would you like to check your account balance? And you're given two button options on the screen, yes or no.
And you agree that that's a balancing inquiry?
And we agree that's, well, not yet. Plaintiff Covell pressed the yes button, and then the second screen is the account selection screen, where you get to choose checking or savings.
Sure.
And at that point, when she selected checking, a balance inquiry occurred. We don't understand that. We recognize that's a valid one. If transmission is made by the ATM machine to Ms. Covell's home bank, Bank of America, electronic transmission for a balance inquiry request, B of A then sends back her available balance information for her checking account, and at the same time assesses her fee of $2.50 for a balance inquiry. And so when that information is sent back to the machine, it is now on the next screen, her checking account available balance is shown on the screen. And this screen is the crux of this lawsuit, because right under where balance information that she just inquired and paid for is displayed, it asks the compound question, would you like to print your account balance and continue the transaction? And you're only given two button options. One is cancel, and if you press cancel, the entire session ends, and you can't get to the intended cash withdrawal or anything else. If you press continue, that's the only option to proceed with your intended cash withdrawal. And so that's what Brittany Covell did. She pressed yes, continue. And the crux of this case is whether this screen, which we've referenced in our brief as the received screen, constitutes a balance inquiry prompt or not. And I'll get more into the reasons for that later. But she then proceeds to make her cash withdrawal. And so, what happens when she presses the continue button is, even though all she's doing is printing the information that she already paid for and she already has inquired, and it's just printing that information on a receipt and continue to the rest of her transactions, the machine sent Bank of America another balance inquiry request transmission.
So I'm wondering, in the deposit agreement, and that's what's given to the consumer, in the deposit agreement, does it spell out what balance inquiry is? Does it lay out this particular situation where the ATM itself is sending balance inquiries to the bank?
So we believe that the contract expressly sets forth everything we need to know to understand, for a consumer to understand what they should be expecting. So it specifically says the word balance inquiry, and it specifically says the bank will operate based on instructions you give at the ATM. It doesn't say We operate based on instructions, whatever instructions the ATM machine gives us. It's what you instructed to us through the ATM. And even the term balancing inquiry. An inquiry dictionary definition is to request information.
Okay, but my question is, maybe you can answer that part. Is balance inquiry defined in the deposit agreement?
Not anything more additional than the terms that we've identified.
And who wrote the deposit agreement?
And of course, it's Bank of America. It's the deposit agreement and the schedule of fees. These are adhesive contracts drafted by Bank of America that every customer must agree to in order to be a customer. And
where do you think the district court went wrong in saying what Bank of America did was okay?
So I think there's a couple of things here. And I think one thing, you know, I mentioned earlier at the outset that this case once involved multiple defendants. And I think the district court got caught up. One of the things it got caught up was a lot of the language and arguments we used primarily with respect to a different ATM defendant's ATM machine, Cartronics, which is the largest independent ATM operator in the country. We had used certain language that about whether a customer's intended to do these balance inquiries. But I think the thing that we wanted to make clear in this appeal is that from the very outset of the case, from the Third Amendment complaint, that is the operative complaint, through all the briefs that we have filed in the underlying motions, we have made clear that our theory as to our claims against B of A, these contract claims, with respect to their customers' use of FCTI screens, had nothing to do with subjective intent, because our argument is you can't double charge out of network fees for balance inquiries when only one balance inquiry happened. And I think one of the things that the trial court got hung up on was the language about potentially, you know, knowledge or people's intents, which was really an argument that we had made with regards to the Cartronics case, which is no longer part of this case. I think that was one aspect of it. But I think another aspect of it is that I think the trial court is letting B of A off the hook because B of A itself was not the originator of this deceptive Spain switch prompt. And that is to say, B of A did not design FCTI's interface. B of A did not have FCTI's interface transmit these things through non-balancing grid prompts. And so I think the district court felt that felt bad about trying to impute the conduct of a third party to B of A. But I think where that's an error is that these claims are under breach of contract. Unlike common law fraud, which has never been asserted against B of A in this case, knowledge and intent by B of A is not an element of anything we have to prove here. They could be completely innocent in all of this, but if their contract says we only assess out-of-network fees for balance inquiries that you instructed at the machine, then they go ahead and assess out-of-network fees for balance inquiries went through balance through prompts that aren't even balance inquiries.
Let me ask you this. Let's say that if we were to agree on your breach of contract claim and we were to remand, what impact does that have on your breach of implied covenant claim?
Because
aren't they really duplicative?
We view those as being separate. I think the California law is pretty clear that when a party expressly reserves discretion, contractual discretion to any element of its conduct, that the covenant of good faith and fair dealing applies to the application of that discretion. And in here, B of A makes clear in at least two instances that we may charge you the fee. It doesn't say that we will always charge you the fee. We exercise discretion. And in fact, they actually don't charge the fee at all to its wealthiest customers who have such high balances that they automatically waive all those fees. And so when you have a situation where they have contractually, expressly inserted discretion for themselves, they have to apply it with good faith. And then now we get to kind of the other things we're talking about. We go to the fact that whether they intended or were motivated at all in trying to make extra money from this scheme that FCTI was doing. What we know is that they took 90% of the profits from those fees. Only, less than 25 cents ultimately went to the ATM operator. So They're the ones that collected all the fees. They're the ones that made the promise that we're going to assess the fees based on.
But if we decide that it was a breach of contract by BLA to charge more than the $1,250 for the balance inquiry, then your implied covenant claim is duplicative, isn't it? Well, then it wouldn't be any discretion if we held that they can only charge the fee when a customer explicitly requests a balance inquiry.
Admittedly, the breach of contract claim is not our primary claim. Our primary claim is the breach of good faith is not our primary claim. The contract claim is the primary claim, and I don't mind focusing most of our efforts today.
So I share the concern Judge Gilman raised. If you prevail on your breach of contract claim, don't we just dismiss the claim for the implied covenant?
We would certainly accept that as a result. Did you have any other questions, Your Honors?
I don't. Do you have any other point, or do you want to reserve the rest of your time?
Let's see. I've got 4 minutes. I'm just going to make a couple of sort of broad picture points. The thing that we're battling here is that we have a mountain of evidence we've talked about BFA's ATM manager. We've talked about, in our additional evidence that we're able to procure about the ATM networks, other ATM, other banks that have all asserted that this is not a balancing group problem. These fees are assessed in error. There's the case that we were able to derive all this additional information is the Pove versus FCTI case.
I guess I don't understand what you just said. It was assessed in error. BMA doesn't know this is happening. I mean, what do you mean?
My point is that nobody in the industry thinks that this is a valid balancing group. And that's the additional information we got. But my last point I want to make is that what we're battling here is just pure speculation on the part of B of A. There's been no evidence that any single individual has testified that they thought this was a valid balancing group prompt. So I'll just leave it at that.
All right. Thank you. Good morning, counsel.
Good morning. May it please the court, Sean Obi with Winston & Strawn for Bank of America. Contrary to what plaintiff has just argued, she is actually trying to shoehorn a consumer fraud claim into this case in order to make Bank of America liable for ATM screens it does not control or design or have any visibility into. And by making Bank of America contractually liable for anything that happens at those screens, she is effectively charging it with policing all of these hundreds of thousands of independent ATM operators.
Well, hold on. Who contracted with those ATMs? Did the consumers contract with them?
No, it is.
Who contracted with them?
It is the sponsoring banks through the ATM network.
Okay, Bank of America in this case, correct?
Oh, yes, the deposit agreement in place is with Bank of America.
Okay, and so with regards to these ATM notices that are sent out, these balance inquiry notices, I'm assuming that that's your point, that those are controlled by the consumer or by the ATM. Is that what you're saying?
Your Honor, the balance inquiries come through the ATM network through an electronic message. And that is the case regardless of what is being shown on the ATM screen.
Okay, well, I guess answer his question or answer his point. His point is, hey, I've paid for, let's assume that we agree that as soon as I select, I want to know what my balance is for my checking account. So at that point, the deposit agreement says, yes, you're going to get charged because of this balance inquiry, $250. Okay, but then when you get to the other screen and it shows that do you want this printed and continued, that at that point, what is your response or why is it that the consumer should be charged an additional $2.50 and why shouldn't Bank of America be liable for that?
Well, Your Honor, it's because Bank of America, this is breach of contract case. This is not a consumer deception case. And there are remedies for the consumer in place, as plaintiff well knows. As
I'm sorry, you're not answering my question. Go back to my question. My question is, or let me ask it a different question. Maybe I wasn't clear. In the deposit agreement, where does it spell out that the consumer has to pay this additional fee? Can you tell me that?
Yes, okay. Your Honor. It says that when you use a non-Bank of America ATM, yes, you may be charged a fee for a balance inquiry, and that is $2.50 each. The contract also provides that you authorize us to act on the instructions you give us through the ATMs. And I think that's really important, Your Honor, the through ATMs. There is no other way for this to work, for customers to transact out of network without Bank of America relying on the electronic messages.
There's a way that Bank of America, you can contract that out with a subcontractor, in this case the ATM companies who are providing the service. You can tell them, hey, we're talking about one balance inquiry when they are asking for their balance, can't you?
No, Your Honor, it's undisputed that Bank of America has no relationship to FCTI. That is not the way the ATM ecosystem works. And essentially what plaintiff is trying to do is to charge through the contract Bank of America with this duty to oversee essentially all of the screens that's in place on these out-of-network ATMs. There is simply no ability for it to do that. And the interpretation that she urges on this court results in a contract that Bank of America did not and could not have made. She made the point earlier that intent does not matter because this is a breach of contract, but it does. Contract formation matters. The intent of the parties matter. And there's simply no way that Bank of America would have agreed to police all of these screens. That's not the way it works.
So let's assume that the agreement between the ATM out of network people and the bank were such that every time you press any button, first of all, it's checking or savings. Or do you want checking? Or do you, how much do you want on checking? Or do you want me to print a final receipt? And say it generated three or four. What was considered balance inquiries? There were three or four $2.50 fees. Is that okay? Even though the customer only thought he was making one balance inquiry.
Well, what it is not is a breach of contract claim against her issuing bank. What it is, if there's problems with the screens, that needs to be taken up with the designers of those deceptive screens and those who have insight and control over them, perhaps the sponsoring bank as well.
I'm sure the IT departments of the Bank of America could have instructed to be sure that when it gets any inquiry beyond the first one from a customer at an out-of-network ATM to not charge $2.50.
Respectfully.
When the customer goes into 7-Eleven into an out-of-network, the first time that you want to balance, your balance, $2.50, and then don't have any further charge on that inquiry.
Your Honor, regardless of what is shown on the screen, and plaintiff admits she doesn't challenge the first one, it's only the second one. Both times it comes through as an electronic message to Bank of America. There's no information about the screen environment. It's a very standardized message. And Bank of America, under the network rules, is required to respond with the information.
They're not required to charge $2.50, though, counsel.
Well, Your Honor, the bank's ability to assess the fees in connection with ATMs is protected under the law, the National Banking Act.
Right, but you control your definition in the agreement, and you call it a balanced inquiry. You don't define it. You don't say this could include many charges for the same balance, for example.
Well, Your Honor, no, it doesn't, but it doesn't need to, because the language is clear of what customers can expect, and that is when you read the contract together, when you use an out-of-network ATM, you may be charged the $250 each, and you authorize us to act on the instructions you give us through the ATM.
Is it actually true that if for high net worth or high credit balance or account balance customers, the bank doesn't charge any fees at all for inquiries?
For certain products, that is true, but not for the account net issue here.
Right, but it shows that the bank can program its internal things to not generate a $2.50 fee for balance inquiries if it wants for certain accounts.
Respectfully, Your Honor, I don't believe that that is in the record. The Bank of America's ability to issue refunds after the fact does not constitute a breach at the time of formation of the contract.
And your point, and your position is that we're entitled to charge that amount, regardless if it was a mistake of the ATM.
Under a breach of contract claim, yes, Your Honor, it is. This is, if she is faced with a tricky out-of-network screen or something that plaintiff says is not an objective balance inquiry, customers are not left without a remedy. They can, as plaintiff's counsel has already done, bring consumer protection claims against the ATM operators for deception, which is what they've done, but that is not this case. And whatever claims she has about these screens should not be adjudicated through a breach of contract claim with her issuing bank. And that is provided by the terms of the contract itself, but it's only bolstered by the extrinsic evidence in this case. And that is that requests for balance information comes through via the network with standardized messages that say nothing about the screen environment. And so Bank of America cannot make a determination about what is on the screen. Bank of America is not allowed under the network rules to reject a request for a bank or for a balance inquiry unless there are certain circumstances that are present here. And it's undisputed that Bank of America has no relationship with FCTI, has no oversight or insight into its screens. These are not Bank of America ATMs. And Bank of America is not the sponsoring bank who is charged under the network rules with ensuring out-of-network ATM operators like FCTI comply with them. So, in that way...
Go ahead, Judge.
Could I ask you a question, counsel?
Yes.
Earlier you were talking about the intent of the parties. And so, what evidence is there of intent of the plaintiff here to be charged more than one ATM fee for a balance inquiry?
Well, Your Honor, the plaintiff should, as for her agreement requires, she should report instances of fraud or activity that she disputes, and she did not do that. There are remedies in place if the plaintiff did not expect to be charged that fee, but it can't be based on her definition of what a balance inquiry is, because that...
And why is that in the contract itself? Is there a definition of balance inquiry that says it can include an inquiry made by the ATM without a human decision?
That is not in there, but the language that the bank is authorized to rely on the instructions provided through the ATM is the link, Your Honor.
But instructions, does it say instructions of the ATM as opposed to instructions of the bank's customer?
It says, you authorize us to act on the instructions you give us through the ATMs. And I think the critical part there, Your Honor, is the through the ATMs. The only way for this to work for a customer that goes out of network and wants to use an out-of-network ATM, it has to go through the ATM network. And again, the standardized messages say nothing about the screen. whether it was tricky, whether it was or was not a balance inquiry, as plaintiff now says, it only comes in as an electronic message.
But this goes to Judge Gilman's question earlier that, you know, an ATM could have all sorts of numbers that are buttons that you can press. Bank of America still, and then those send balance inquiries to Bank of America. Bank of America is still charging the $250.
Right, Your Honor, because in that situation, again, it is the difference between plaintiff's definition or desired definition of bank balance inquiry, which is everything that happens on the screen. That information is not knowable. It cannot be knowable the way it works. And
well, there's smart people in IT that can figure those things out, don't you think, counsel?
No, Your Honor, it's not. We have extensive extrinsic evidence about the ATM network and how the messages go through and what the standardized message contains, and it's nothing about the screen environment.
Maybe on your end.
There's nothing in the contract, Your Honor, that would insert that contractual term into the agreement.
Okay. Well, assume it's ambiguous what a balance inquiry is. Wouldn't you still lose because the language would be construed against the bank as the drafter of the document?
No, Your Honor, because the extrinsic evidence in this case only supports Bank of America's position here.
What does that mean?
Well, it shows that plaintiff's desired read of the contract requires Bank of America to know the unknowable, which is the screen environment that she saw. And the extrinsic evidence is the network rules, the way the sponsoring banks are charged with, and to be clear, Bank of America is not a sponsoring bank. The sponsoring bank here was Prosperity Bank. They are charged with overseeing the independent ATM operators. That's the way ATM operators can participate in the network. It's not Bank of America's role or any other issuing bank's role to monitor the activity of the out-of-network ATM. And, Your Honor, if a contract is capable, to answer your question, of two constructions, courts are bound to give an interpretation that will make it lawful, operative, definite, reasonable, and capable of being carried into effect. And plaintiff's definition of balance inquiry, which is what happens on these screens that Bank of America doesn't see or control, it's not reasonable or capable of being carried into effect. And instead, balance inquiry can only be defined as the electronic message that traveled through the ATM network that was triggered from her selections at the FCTI machine that she authorized Bank of America to act on.
Counsel, I see your time is up. Do you want to make a final point?
Again, I just want to say that to the extent that there are concerns that the customer is left without a remedy, again, I would just reiterate that that is not the case. For full service leading screens, everything is working as it should against FCTI, the maker of these screens. The consumer is not remedyless. But what plaintiff does not have here is a breach of contract claim against the issuing bank.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Your Honors, unless you have any specific questions, I would just like to make a final statement. One point I'd like to make is that the point I was trying to make before I sat down is that in the other case, the Pove versus FDI case, that court issued an opinion on class cert. It came out after BFA's responsive brief. It came out a couple weeks before our reply brief, I believe. We failed to cite it, and out of respect for defendant, I won't argue right now, but we did notify them of the order as soon as it had come out. I just want to give the case site, so in case the court's interested, it's Pove versus FCTI, 2024 Westlaw 322050. That's Southern District of New York with Judge Ray Coffey. And he issued.
Counsel, if I could ask you, because the district court didn't address class certification, if we were to rule for you on the breach of contract claim, wouldn't we necessarily want to remand to the district court to address your class claim?
Your Honor, the district court denied our motion for class certification, and that's one of the parts of the opinion that's subject to this appeal, and we've pointed out numerous errors in abuse of discretion, and we believe that, again, we're not fighting against anything. Nobody has presented any evidence that anyone thinks that this was a valid balancing inquiry.
You didn't directly answer Judge Miller's question. You would want us to remand the class.
So we would want to remand, but I would go a step further and request this court to just reverse the trial court's decision on class cert and grant it. But at the very least, of course,
when the court denied certification and it also denied the basic claim.
Yes.
So how could it certify a class if the claim of the named plaintiff was invalid?
Right. So I understand your point, Your Honor, and I think the district court didn't need to weigh on class cert once it decided that the individual class reps or potential class reps claim was dismissed, but because the district court anyway issued an opinion on it, that's why we felt that we had to address that in this appeal as well.
Thank you, counsel.
And then just one last point. I'll say.
All right, just one second. Yeah. Judge Cole, do you have any other questions?
No, thanks, Judge Mendoza.
Very well. All right, thank you, counsel. Thank you to both of you. This matter will stand submitted.